Well, welcome everyone, and good evening. So glad that you're here to join us for our Good Friday service. We're going to get started in just a moment, but we'd like to open it in prayer. Oh, Lord, we are just excited to be here and choosing to remember the cross, to remember the events of this day that literally really took place many, many years ago. And so I just pray, Lord, that the message of the cross would be so real to all of us, and it would lead to just a real change in our lives, a real change in our relationship with you, and a change in the way we treat and interact with others, Lord. And so we just commit this time to you, God. We invite you to be here and to be with us. We want you to get all the glory today, Jesus. And so we choose now to make the cross our focus. We choose now to remember. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Isaiah 53. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed.
Once and for all, the Father's love, he is the light in the darkness, took on flesh and took our place, the weight of the world on his shoulders, the weight of the world on his shoulder. We believe our God is Jesus. We believe that he is Lord. We believe that he has saved us from sin and death. Once God from from God, light from life. You are our salvation, Jesus, Jesus. God from God, light from light. Your kingdom is forever. We believe our God is Jesus. We believe that He is Lord. We believe that He has saved us from sin and death once and for all. From sin and death once and for all. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall, thought of me above. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like the rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Crucified, lay behind the stone, die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall with all me above. Like rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall with all of me above all.
Now every one of us here tonight knows that there's something wrong inside. We have a tendency within us that disturbs us. We long for victory over sin, sins of thought and word and deed. And the Bible reveals that we are born radically wrong. We are members of a human race that has turned its back upon God. There's something inside that makes it easier to go wrong than to go right. And some deep evil seems to sap the human race. There's a bias in the bowl that takes it off course. There's a gravity that pulls us down when we want to rise high in spiritual attainment. And the secret is that something within us has died. The spiritual part of our being that God gave us has died because of sin. This is the reason why we can neither see nor enter the kingdom of heaven unless there is a radical change. And here is a great revelation from Holy Scripture. And we also know it in our own experience that we cannot make this radical change ourselves. That God says you must have, you must know, you must experience if you are ever to see or enter the kingdom of heaven. Why the cross? Because on the cross, the Lord Jesus Christ was made sin for you. He bore your sin, sir, in his body on the tree. He was the only man who ever went through hell on earth. And he did it for you. To cleanse you from the stain of sin, to deliver you from the power of sin, to clear you from the penalty of sin, so that there can be nothing between you and God. Christ Jesus bore your sin in his body on the tree. So, ladies and gentlemen, we come to this great conclusion tonight, that unless God is willing to do something about it, we are sunk, and there is no hope of us ever entering or seeing the kingdom of heaven. But here is the Christian gospel, ladies and gentlemen. Here is the good news. That God loves us. Because he loves us, he's willing, he's yearning to undertake this great change for us, if only we are willing. And because Christ has died and risen again, I have wonderful news for you here tonight. Hundreds of you here yearn to know what it is to be in the kingdom of God. Hundreds of you want to know the victory that God gives to those that belong to Christ. If you will repent, believe and confess, God will do the rest. He will come into your cleansed being that he now possesses, and he will live his life in you. He will give you eternal life, divine life. Right now, you will enter the kingdom of heaven, and you will live in the kingdom of heaven whilst you're on earth. And when death comes, it won't be death. You'll be with Christ, and you'll go into the glories of eternal heaven. That is what God will do for you tonight, if you will repent and believe and confess it.
Blessed Redeemer.
And rejected by mankind. A man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
A while back when Pastor Chuck asked me to teach the Good Friday service today, I really stopped and asked the Lord what he would want us to do as a church family. The reason is that as believers in Jesus Christ, there can be a danger with familiarness, knowing we're going to take communion, knowing we're going to talk about the cross, because there can be a general knowledge we have of Jesus, of the cross. And I just wonder, though, are we really stopping to think of the magnitude of the cross? And so today, rather than teach a long sermon, I want to read the account of the cross from Matthew chapter 27 and then point out a few simple truths. And then after, we'll partake of communion together. But before I read, again, Matthew 27, if you want to follow along, let's set up the scene. Jesus has been brought before Pontius Pilate to stand trial. And as we'll read in a moment, Pilate knew that Jesus was innocent. Pilate knew the Jewish leaders were accusing him because of their envy. And at one point, Pilate tried to release Jesus. But yet the pressure mounted. And the Jewish leaders and the crowd's voices were too loud. It was too great for him. And eventually he buckled and gave in to their demands. And a riot was about to break out. And Pilate didn't want that happening on his watch. And in order to avoid this uproar, he didn't want to get in their way. And so they threatened him of not being a friend of Caesar. And this was a very severe accusation. He had already been accused before, and he wanted to avoid the charge again at any cost. So he washed his hands in front of the crowd and said, "I am innocent of this man's blood." And Pilate had Jesus scourged and then delivered him to be crucified. And after our Savior was scourged and tormented and really terrorized, it's hard to fathom the cruelty getting any worse, but it did. Now, the soldiers stripped our Lord of his clothing, and they placed a scarlet, a purple robe on his open wounds of his flesh, and a crown of thorns was thrust upon his head. In Matthew's account of the crucifixion and the depictions that we read in the other Gospels, tell us of the great suffering that our Lord endured. So let's go to Matthew 27, and we'll read beginning in verse 1. Early in the morning, all of the chief priests and elders of the people made their plans how to have Jesus executed. So they bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Jesus, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left, and he went away and hanged himself. And the chief priest picked up the coins and said, "It is against the law to put this into the treasury, since it is blood money." So they decided to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. And that is why it has been called the field of blood to this day. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took 30 pieces of silver, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field as the Lord commanded me. Verse 11, meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. And then Pilate asked him, "Do you hear the testimony they are bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Now it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Jesus or Barabbas, who was called the Messiah, for he knew it was out of self-interest that they had handed Jesus over to him. And while Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message: "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. And they all answered, "Crucify him." "Why, what crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." And when Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." And all the people answered, "His blood is on us and on our children." And then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Verse 27, then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put him in a scarlet robe and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him. They took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. And after they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him, and they led him away to crucify him. And as they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. And they came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall, but after tasting, he refused to drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. So save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." And in the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross and we will believe. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I'm the Son of God.'" And in the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. Verse 45, from noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over the land. And about 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And when some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." And immediately one of them ran and got a sponge and he filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a staff and offered it to Jesus to drink. And the rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus has cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. And at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from bottom to top. The earth shook and the rocks split and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life, and they came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. Verse 54, when the centurion and those who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." So there's just a few things I want to notice and have us contemplate. One of them is found in verse 45. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over the land. There was this darkness that came upon all of the land. And from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, it's 12 to 3. This darkness was not due to a solar eclipse. This is the full moon of the Passover would have put the moon out of place for an eclipse like this, but rather this speaks to the reality of Jesus taking our place of suffering instead of us. You see, darkness would have been the consequence. Darkness would have suffered for our own sins. And after that, Jesus cried out the famous words in verse 46, my God, why have you forsaken me? Immediately, many of the Jewish leaders would have recognized some of these words from Psalm 22. This prophetic song written by King David predicts the way the Messiah, the son of David, was to be killed. In Psalm 22, beginning in verse 1, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then if you go to verse 16, for dogs have surrounded me, a band of evildoers has encompassed me. They pierced my hands and my feet, I can count all my bones. They look, they stare at me, they divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Church, by Jesus being forsaken in our place, he made a way. He made a way that we might be brought into a living relationship with God. In fact, in verse 51, Matthew records, and behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. You see, the veil in the temple is what kept everyone separated from the holiest place in the temple, the place where the glory of God dwelt. But it's through the death of Jesus Christ that God made a way for us. He made a way for us to have a relationship with him. The veil has been torn in two. Ephesians 2:13 tells us, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were formerly far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. And in Hebrews 10, verse 19, therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by new and living way, which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Imagine how our lives would be changed if we truly understood what it meant to live in the presence of God. If we realized that literally that veil had been torn in two and we can now enter into the presence of our God through Jesus Christ. In the Gospel of John 9:19, it says, later, knowing that everything had now been finished and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I'm thirsty. This is a different account of the same event. A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge on it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. It is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and he gave his spirit. Church, it is finished. This is a declaration of victory. It is over. It is finished. The debt for our sin has been paid. Jesus has canceled the debt. Jesus has defeated the enemy of our souls. And so now there is a reason to rejoice. And now there is reason to shout. Now there is reason to respond in loving God with all of our hearts. Colossians 2, beginning in verse 13. When you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against it, which was hostile to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. When he had disarmed the rulers and authority, he made a public display of them, having triumphed over them through him. So the conclusion is this: no one took Jesus' life away. He willingly offered himself as a sacrifice for our sins. There was no other way. It's through Jesus that sin is defeated. It is through Jesus that death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, how great the love of God is for us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him may have eternal life. You see, we stand condemned because of our sins. And I was reflecting on this as we were opening in worship, that it's easy to say your sins, but it's challenging to say my sins. It's my sins that led Jesus to the cross. It's my sins that deserve eternal punishment and separation from God. We stand condemned because of our sins, destined to perish, excluded from eternal life with God. But Jesus was forsaken for us instead of us. Amen? And so the story of the cross should always draw us into repentance, thankfulness, and gratitude. And so on this Good Friday, what is your response? What is your response to the passage we read? Do you believe? Will you choose today to receive all that the Lord has for you? In just a moment, we're going to make communion available to you all. And communion is a few things. One, communion is a call to confession. Again, acknowledging our sin, our shortcomings, our own wickedness. And it's where we choose to lay our sins down at the foot of the cross. Communion is a call to confession, but communion is also a call to grace and repentance. We accept the death of Jesus Christ as penalty for our sins. Communion is a call to freedom and redemption, knowing that Jesus conquered sin. That there is now victory over the temptations we have because Jesus conquered sin. And communion is also a call to remember. At the Last Supper with his disciples, Jesus asked them to remember. And so tonight we will choose to remember. To remember Christ's body and blood that was given for the forgiveness of our sins. And it will remind us that we're all sinners, and we are all saved only by the grace of God. And please know tonight, that grace is available to you. If you would cry out in faith, if you would say, Lord, I'm a sinner in need of being saved. Oh, please know the Lord is there to welcome you. And to say, oh, child, oh, son, oh, daughter, please come home. I'm the Heavenly Father you've been longing for. Communion is a time for us to reflect on the sacrifice and the love of Jesus. The cracker, as you take it, it simply reminds us of the body of Jesus that was beaten and bruised, tattered and torn for us. The juice represents the blood of Jesus, which was shed to purchase the freedom from our sin. And so we're going to continue in a few songs of worship, and I would just invite you, if you're here with your family today, to maybe share communion with your family. This is something I'm learning now that I have young girls, is really just learning how to be not only a dad but a spiritual leader to my girls. And so I'm beginning to pray with them, and we've had such beautiful times, and they have such sweet prayers that they pray. And so I just encourage you that if your family's here tonight, gather them up. And if you don't know what to say, if you're like, I've never really prayed with my family, just say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross. We choose to remember you. If you're here by yourself, hey, the Lord is here with you. Your church family is here with you. Just go and get the elements of communion. They're in the back of the room. Just as the Lord leads, sit before him for a little while and just reflect. And I pray that you would have in your hearts, a remembrance of what he has done for you, what he went through to purchase your freedom, ultimately how the love of God was on display for all of us. Let's worship and take of communion together.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Savior alone carried the cross for all of my debts, paid the cost, salvation complete, now forever I'm free. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. Don't praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. The power on earth, not even the grave, can separate us from mercy and grace. He's faithful to save, and his blood never fails. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. No one but Jesus can make us pure as snow. Stand in your freedom. Calvary covers it all. It's no one but Jesus can make us pure as snow. We stand in freedom. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all.
Amen. What's wonderful about there only being one way and it being the blood of Jesus is that it gets us out of the equation. And what that means is that we don't have to wonder whether we're living up to it. And it goes beyond our social status. It goes beyond our gender. It goes beyond all of those different things. It just comes down to one thing. It just says, have you received it? And that makes us one. Today, we have had prayer since noon. And I have seen in the past few hours the body of Christ love each other. And people come in who I don't know, people that I do know, people that I've seen, but I haven't really known who they are. And we have this instant connection because we have the blood of Jesus and we're Christians. And it's been amazing today to watch people minister to one another. And the Lord did something really wonderful today, right when we started, right as I was unlocking the door. We just had a brother come in, and he just needed prayer. He was just really struggling. He needed prayer, and one of our guys just began to just really pray for him. And really, the Lord began to speak through this one who was praying for the other. And this man who came in, he began to confess his sins, and he gave his life to the Lord right there, and he's going to get baptized. He signed up to get baptized. And I'll tell you what, it kicked off. It was like getting a touchdown in the first 30 seconds of the game, and it just started the whole day off. Hey, we're going to keep that prayer going till midnight. We're going to stay here. We're going to keep on praying. I've asked some people to come just to make sure I had some people here with me. But if you want to stay and just pray, you can stay as long as you want. You can stay till midnight, or you can go out, grab some dinner, come back, whatever you want to do. But today has been a day of a lot of just ministry to one another. And we just have this one common thread, and that's the blood of Jesus. And God's been doing great things today. So I just want to encourage you to continue with this service. And if you're able to stay and pray with us today, we're going to be right over in this area, or you can just stay anywhere you want to. You can pray by yourself, pray with people, whatever you want to do. But praise God for the body of Christ, and praise God that we're a church because of what He did for us. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great rest of your day. By the way, I was supposed to announce this Easter morning. 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and 10 o'clock. Make sure you get to one of those services as well. God bless you.